Willnessly.com. Willnessly.
Welcome back to CNN 10. It's great to have you watching on this January 7th. I'm Carl Azus at the CNN Center, and we're starting the week with what's been called the biggest surprise of the economic cycle. American employers added 312,000 jobs to the U.S. economy in the month of December. Most experts had estimated they'd add 181,000 jobs. One analyst says the fact that so many more jobs were counted indicates that a possible recession, a sustained decrease in the economy, is not going to happen anytime soon. The percentage of the American labor force that doesn't have a job, the unemployment rate, increased to 3.9% in December. It was at 3.7% the month before. Experts say that's because more Americans got back into the workforce looking for a job. The report also indicated that paychecks on average also increased, with employers offering more money to attract new workers. So overall, good news for the U.S. economy. The head of the U.S. Central Bank called the report very strong. And because of that, and some other events that reassured investors, the U.S. stock market jumped up Friday. The Dow Jones Industrial Average rose 747 points then. It was the fourth biggest point increase of all time for the index of 30 major stocks. In fact, every sector of the market increased on Friday. We reported last week how the market saw some major ups and downs in 2018, with several of them setting records. It's possible that more big swings could be ahead.
Stock market volatility is the new normal. But let's not forget, volatility is the old normal too. Yes, 2018 saw the return of mad market swings. On five different days, the Dow moved 1,000 points or more. Moves that big have only happened 8 times in history. So the fact that 5 of them occurred last year is significant. But the market is not more volatile than ever before. Investors just don't remember the roller coaster ride, because for a decade, stocks pretty much just went steadily higher. In fact, spikes in volatility have always been a part of Wall Street's landscape. Just look at this chart going back to 1928. So how long will the current wave of volatility last? Well, probably for a while. Uncertainty about the global economy, particularly in Europe and China, has rattled investors. Trade tensions between the U.S. and China have yet to be resolved. And investors are worried about interest rates. If the Fed raises rates too quickly, it could slow the economy too much, even trigger a recession. For years, investors would buy every dip. Now they seem to sell every rally. So expect more volatility. After a long break, it's back with a vengeance, and it's likely here to stay.
10-second trivia. Where would you find the busiest shipping route in the world? English Channel, Panama Canal, Suez Canal, or Strait of Gibraltar? According to Guinness World Records, the Dover Strait, located in the English Channel, is the world's busiest lane for shipping. There's been an increase in the number of migrants trying to cross that channel, many of them hoping to obtain asylum, permission to stay in the United Kingdom. So far, the numbers are in the hundreds, in contrast to the hundreds of thousands who've crossed the Mediterranean Sea in the migrant crisis that's Europe's largest since World War II. But while the English Channel crossing is much narrower, it's still very dangerous, especially when the people making the journey are often on flimsy boats and don't have life jackets.
Stand on England's southern coast in the right light and you can see France. Those dark shadows against the golden haze. Between them lies a formidable boundary. The channel is at least 19 nautical miles of open water, often with big swells, powerful tides, ships and ferries ploughing up, down, and across it. But recently, much smaller vessels have been crossing too.
Do you need help?
Tiny inflatable boats carrying people from far away. The desperate and determined, risking everything to reach Dover's White Cliffs and make the United Kingdom their home. Out on the channel, charter boat operator Matthew Coker tells us he's had contact with 5 migrant boats in recent months. He recorded video of this moment last year, a small inflatable drifting near the coast.
We see them waving some oars with some t-shirts tied to them. Obviously, it was, you know, they were in distress.
3 men, 1 woman and their tiny boat were brought on board. They'd lost their engine. They were exhausted, dehydrated, and lucky to be alive.
Were you able to talk to these people?
I tried to communicate with them, but they didn't speak English. But I did. They were saying they was from, you know, they kept saying Iran.
Many of those crossing say they're Iranian. Every civilian boat operator is now under orders to look out for them.
Mariners are requested to report any unusual activity or sightings of small vessels transiting the Dover Strait.
Under pressure to act, the British government is also deploying its resources to find and rescue migrants.
There will soon be three of these large Border Force vessels patrolling this stretch of the coast. The government was initially reluctant to bring in extra safety boats because they feared that could encourage more migrants to attempt the crossing. But they've decided saving lives must be the priority.
The minister responsible has questioned whether the migrants are genuine refugees. And some people, including the area's local MP, want those rescued by British vessels to be returned to France.
That way, the migrants and the traffickers who are really driving this, who are behind this, get the message that there's no point trying.
All this is being described by some British newspapers as a migrant crisis, even though the numbers of people arriving on this coast are relatively small, especially compared to migrant crossings in the Mediterranean.
The British government says 539 people tried to cross this water and reach the UK in 2018. Many didn't get close. The French stopped around 42%. But the fact that's got some people concerned, triggered talk of a crisis and inflamed some passion, is the recent increase. Around 80% of the total attempts were in the last 3 months.
Migrant activist Christine Oliver is more concerned about ensuring people's rights to claim asylum.
We should be demonstrating our compassion and our humanity and understanding rather than worrying about the very small numbers that are coming here.
Britain has a proud history of welcoming those in need to its shores, but control over borders and migration are emotive, often divisive issues here. They drove many to vote for Brexit, and they worry some when they see small boats landing uninvited on British beaches. Phil Black, CNN, near Dover on the English Channel.
St. Paul, Minnesota is gearing up for its 133rd annual Winter Carnival. It's the home of the Ice Palace, a sort of frozen castle that recalls a short story by author F. Scott Fitzgerald. There have been dozens of these built in St. Paul over the decades. Across the Pacific, in China's northernmost province, a spectacle of sub-zero wonderment has already opened.
Welcome to Ice and Snow World. It's an annual festival of ice sculptures and colorful lights in China's northeastern city of Harbin, or Ice City as the locals call it. On display, there are cathedrals and palaces more than 10 meters high, alongside smaller, more delicate exhibits. It's hard work for the sculptors, but the reward of having a guaranteed audience to admire their creations makes it all worthwhile.
Unlike other sculptures, which are always placed somewhere after being finished, and we do not know who will see them, we know that the ice and snow sculptures here will definitely be seen by lots of tourists.
The Ice Festival attracts more than a million Chinese and international visitors to Harbin every year, and not even the sub-zero temperature manages to dampen the party atmosphere.
We made sure to wear lots of clothes to keep warm, but I think we could use some more, but I think it's definitely worth it because I don't think there are many places in the world where you can see the things that we can see here.
The festival will remain open until February when temperatures start to warm up. Michael Holmes, CNN.
There's been a new visitor making the rounds at a cat cafe, so of course this would rate 10 out of 10. Vector is the name of a toy robot that can do simple things for people like tell the weather or set a timer. But it can't see pets, so its engineers brought it here so that it could take pictures and be programmed to identify cats. Some of the animals seemed mildly amused, some didn't. We're not sure what Vector would do if a cat attacked, but Vector probably wouldn't be Victor. Not sure how many bites it would take, but with too much hard wear, the robot could short Sir Cat. It could get its whiskers crossed. If it tips over, the results could be dreadful. And with cats on the prowl, they'd have to closely monitor Vector. It's a good thing it doesn't come with a mouse. I'm Carl Azouz for CNN 10.